This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream. Get access to my streaming video service Nebula when you sign up for CuriosityStream using the link in the description.
I don't know how these big booktubers do it. I only have the inner strength to read like one of these Lolita reimaginings per year, and it nearly kills me every time. Anyways, on with the show.
Hi YouTube, my name is Lola, I'm a stereotypical English major, and today I want to talk about an adaptation of Lolita called Roger Fishbite. This video today is a little less scripted than my usual videos, but I just finished the book and I have a lot to talk about. I'm really fascinated by adaptations of Lolita for a myriad of reasons. Not only is it my favorite book, but it's incredibly popular. And yet despite being so popular, it's often adapted so poorly. The source material is so well known and yet notoriously difficult to work with. And one of the most common types of Lolita adaptations are retellings from her perspective. Last year I covered Lo's Diary, and I felt like it had a lot of the same problems as Roger Fishbite. On paper, it sounds like such a good idea to do an adaptation from Lo's perspective, and there actually are works written from the perspective of the victim that have been heavily inspired by Lolita that are excellent. I've mentioned Paula Vogel a few times on this channel, but How I Learned to Drive is one of my favorites. Like, not just adaptations or works that are inspired by Lolita, but just favorites ever.
Paula Vogel's disturbing memory play, How I Learned to Drive, made a splash when it premiered off-Broadway in 1997. It garnered a flood of acclaim for stars Mary Louise Parker and David Morse, and it went on to win the Pulitzer Prize.
It's been 23 years, Paula, and this show is going to Broadway, finally. How does that feel for you?
When I wrote this play, I thought, people are going to stone me for talking openly about this topic.
So I guess what I'm saying is it can be done. I just don't see it going well most of the time. Right off the bat, I will say that I liked Roger Fishbite a lot more than Lo's Diary. Although I didn't really like it, I felt like it was a lot more cohesive, and I felt like artistically it had a leg up as well. And I also don't want to imply that the authors of these books don't really get Lolita. I think a lot of the time we all feel like we're the only person in the world who gets our favorite book, but you know, the sad truth about Lolita is that because of a lot of people's in-life personal experiences, also their love of literature, there are a lot of people who truly do get Lolita. And in exploring Lolita online, I have truly made some excellent friends. And I also invited them to read some of the quotes for this video, so I will be reading a lot of the book aloud and talking about it, but some of it will be read by them as well.
There's Jamie Loftus, who's the creator of Lolita Podcast, which is pretty much the definitive internet work on Lolita. It's insightful, it's inquisitive, it's a tearjerker. I can't recommend all of her podcasts enough, and I've been so thrilled to collaborate with her. There's Nalija, who has a YouTube channel where she discusses aesthetics and Tumblr culture in general. Her work is basically internet anthropology, and she's given me a ton of insight into what nymphette slash coquette Tumblr was like, for which I'm super grateful because I was not there. If you're interested in how the internet has reacted to Lolita and historically revisioned the derivative coquette subculture, you should go watch her videos. And there's Skylar Rain, who primarily covers nymphette fashion, and she's pretty much the expert when it comes to the word nymphette and its usage. Her work has even been given the thumbs up by Brian Boyd, who is the world's biggest Vladimir Nabokov scholar. My thumbs up pales in comparison, but I'll give it anyway. You should go watch her stuff.
So there's that category of people who get Nabokov as well. There's the academics, like Brian Boyd. I'm currently making my way through this one. So yeah, I don't want to make the claim that Emily Prager doesn't get Lolita. And she's clearly lived a very interesting and prolific life as a writer. She, I believe at one point, was an actress and was on SNL.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're happy to have her back with us. Please welcome Emily Prager. Emily! Now, what is this thing in the front? It looks like some sort of protective
vest.
Well,
it's a little pinafore. That's what it is. It's a little bit fascist fashion.
Uh-huh. That's, you know? Well, certainly interesting. Now, what's this deal? Is that yours?
That's something I add. It's a leather bracelet.
It's very nice.
Yeah, tarnished innocence is my favorite thing.
She's done a lot of humor writing and TV criticism. And what's pertinent to Roger Fishbite is the fact that she grew up in Texas and Greenwich Village. So I do want to tread lightly because I feel like there might be some elements of this book that are personal. As far as I know, I couldn't find a ton of information online. This book was controversial upon release, and it received a lot of mixed reviews, and even the inside book jacket says,
"This is a remarkable novel that is as captivatingly readable as it is undeniably controversial."
I'm not really sure if they're talking about the subject matter or the book itself, so interesting. The book's dedication, I really appreciated. It reads,
"To all the little girls I've met who started out in desperate circumstances, it is their boundless determination and unstoppable joy in life that profoundly influenced this book."
Hello everyone, future Lola here, dropping in for a quick channel update and to tell you about my sponsor. It's been a bit of a tough stretch since I am graduating soon, hopefully. So I've been doing a bajillion classes, running around, applying to grad schools and PhD programs. But this semester, I'm hoping to do a lot more video content. I also just hired another co-writer who is featured in this video. It's my pal, Nalija. I will link her in the description. I'm really grateful that we got to talking because of Jamie Loftus's Lolita podcast, and overall I'm just really eager to bring new content to the table this year. So as you may know, my recent video on the Walt Disney Company was ironically struck down by Studio Ghibli. They are extremely litigious and they gave me a copyright strike. But the silver lining is the folks at Nebula stepped in and helped me out. All of my content is now available through Nebula, which I am absolutely stoked about. And I also have my first sponsor, which is, drumroll please, CuriosityStream. My channel is now made possible with support from CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream is a subscription streaming service with thousands of nonfiction titles. As a bit of a documentary fiend myself, I've had a ton of fun checking out what they have to offer. In particular, I'm working on a script for a long-awaited BoJack Horseman video, and they actually have a documentary on Secretariat's jockey, Ron Turcotte, fittingly called Ron Turcotte, Secretariat's Jockey. Anyway, if you like my channel, you probably love literature, you probably love learning. You also probably see all of the, like, Canadian documentaries that I watch on Letterboxd. And the cool thing is, Nebula comes free with CuriosityStream for as long as you use CuriosityStream. So if you get CuriosityStream, you can also check out my Disney video exclusively on Nebula. And to go into just a little bit more detail, Nebula is a streaming platform built by and for independent creators, like Sarah Zed, Lily Alexander, Jesse Gender, or myself. And this is honestly really exciting for me because a lot of the kind of stuff I like to make tends to get copyright struck or demonetized here on YouTube. Like, I'm not really making any money doing this outside of Patreon. So Nebula gives me a bit more freedom to do the kinds of things that didn't really seem possible before. They've helped me a lot with the Studio Ghibli situation, and just in general, they're giving me a place where I can post things that are a little more, tricky and nuanced. All this to say, you can use my URL today. It's curiositystream.com/LolaSebastian. Thanks to CuriosityStream and Nebula. Thanks to my wonderful patrons who are so patient and so extremely generous and encouraging. And thanks to my co-writers, George and Nalija. All right, back to the video. So we're just gonna read the blurb, which should give you a basic idea about what Roger Fishbite is about.
Lucky Linderhoff is cute, worryingly precocious, and sassy. She's also in a juvenile detention facility awaiting trial for the murder of the man she calls Roger Fishbite. Gripping, funny, and disturbing, Emily Prager's novel tells Lucky's story for our brash, affluent, talk show times in the half-innocent, half-knowing voice of the nymphette herself.
I don't know how I feel about the use of the word nymphette right off the bat, but continue.
The acclaimed author of A Visit from the Footbinder is a wickedly funny writer with a deadly serious aim. She has given us Lucky's revenge in a dazzling, provocative sexual comedy and a razor-sharp indictment of a crazy world that asks four-year-old beauty queens to pout and wiggle, but fails to see the fisheye man who bites.
I'm also not sure how I feel about the phrase sexual comedy, because this book is about a 13-year-old girl. So I think I probably talked about this in my Lowe's Diary video, but one of my persistent issues with Lolita adaptations is that they often have terrible first lines. Terrible is probably a stretch, and to be fair, it's very difficult to do better than Lolita. It's one of the best and most famous opening lines in all of literature. But for comparison, the opening line of Roger Fishbite is,
"A pervert? You were involved with a pervert? Why didn't you tell me? What was he like?"
My friend Eglantine said when she came to visit me in the holding cell.
Another slight observation, the second chapter begins with, "I called him Roger Fishbite right away," right from the first minute that I answered the door and took him to see the basement apartment. I get the feeling that that might have been the original opening. For contrast, here's the opening paragraph of how I learned to drive.
Sometimes, to tell a secret, you first have to teach a lesson. We're going to start our lesson tonight on an early, warm summer evening. It's 1969, and I am very old, very cynical of the world, and I know it all. In short, I'm 17 years old, parking off a dark lane with a married man on an early summer night.
So this really does set the tone for Roger Fishbite, which I've found to be very hooky. It feels like a book that tries very hard to keep your attention, but it also sets kind of a vastly different and spiritually disconnected tone than How I Learned to Drive. And the opening monologue tells us that it's going to be about her journey in healing, in growing, in learning, in surviving, in coming of age. And the only thing that Roger Fishbite, I think, really promises with its opening paragraph is that there's going to be sex and that someone's going to die.
And was there sex?
She asked, scrunching up her eyes and pushing down the thrill of asking me. I smiled at her in such a way that she would remember this moment all her life. Then I yawned with boredom. Yes, I said impatiently. Yes, of course there was sex.
So it's certainly evocative, but for a Lolita adaptation from Lowe's perspective, I'm not sure I totally love the direction that it takes right off the bat. It is already characterizing Lucky Linderhoff as clever and calculated and honestly a bit manipulative. But right from the get-go, we know that it's not really going to be about her emotional journey, nor is it going to be about her relationships with other people. Right off the bat, the book suffers from telling too much and not showing enough. But on the inside, I'm a nervous child and I need to move fast. And that's just the way it has to be. And you know, I'm on page 5 and serious problems are already starting to emerge. First of all, there's the fact that Emily Prager has already characterized Lucky as a girl genius extraordinaire, very similar to Lowe's diary in this regard. This idea that, you know, the tragedy of Lolita comes from the fact that this girl's life is completely ruined by the actions of Humbert. She gets totally derailed, and we would never get to find out what kind of person she grows up to be. I found the more I reread it, the more I catch glimpses, but the sad thing is we never truly know. But, you know, just because we never really get to know who she is doesn't mean we should make her into a super genius rocket scientist master manipulator type. A lot of these from her perspective Lolita adaptations will make it so that Lo was the secret mastermind the whole time, that she was the one in control, she was manipulating him, which first of all, I feel like often that has some really disturbing implications. Roger Fishbite doesn't take that angle so much as Lowe's diary did, which is another one of the reasons why I prefer Roger Fishbite to Lowe's diary. But at the same time, this idea that like the tragedy in Dolores Hayes having her life ruined and her dying is that she could never then grow up to be the gal who cures cancer, it doesn't sit right with me. Frankly, like it doesn't matter if she grew up and became, as she does at the end of Lolita, a young mother, married, living a pretty average life. I feel like what Nabokov is trying to say is that the value of her soul does not change whether she's a rocket scientist or just a gal. What Humbert did was wrong regardless of who she grows up to be, and in comparison, How I Learned to Drive did an excellent job with this because although Lil Bit is incredibly intelligent and grows up to be an academic, her tendency to live inside of her head is actually a result of her trauma.
This is the last day I lived inside my body. I retreated above the neck, and I've lived inside the fire in my head ever since. Although I still have never known what it is to jog or dance, anything that jiggles. The nearest sensation I feel of flight in the body, I guess I feel when I'm driving.
It's not that she wasn't intellectual before, but she focuses on her intellectualism to escape her body. In contrast, Lucky Linderhoff doesn't seem to have that haunting of grief. She's incredibly jaded and over it. Obviously, there is no incorrect trauma response, but I kind of feel like the trauma response was not really written. One could hypothetically make the argument that Lucky is in denial, that she's not really ready to fully face her grief yet. But I actually feel like the book portrays more of a, I'm too cool, I'm too badass to feel sad. Like, if you're going to write a book from the perspective of Dolores Hayes, you might want to focus in on those little glimpses of her agony that Nabokov gives us.
I am not insecure, needy. God, that's a joke. How could I ever be insecure? I was the snowflake queen.
I'm just saying, I've seen it done a handful of times, and I feel like it's way more effective when the trauma is explored, and less effective when Lo is this grand master manipulator. The book also suffers from adjective sickness, and it's one of those things where I'm sure there's a name for it, but I can't remember it right now. You know how J.K. Rowling likes to switch it up and use a lot of words that aren't said? But it inevitably kind of makes the book kind of, just awkward in places. We get passages in Roger Fishbite that are like, "No," he snapped and stalked off toward the moving van. Like, does he really have to snap and stalk in the same sentence? And I think the names in this one are better than in Lo's diary, but nonetheless, they are also really clunky, awkward, and bizarre. Like, there's a side character named Bucky Cheese. There's Lord Wally Krill.
And we enlisted the acting talents of Kima Thep in Harmonia Chen, daughter of the Hong Kong multimillionaire importer, and Sandra Kowtower, daughter of the software billionaire art collectors.
And weirdly, it reminds me of Tyra Banks' Model Land. It's just a bombardment of proper nouns. It should be straightforward, but by the end of the book, it becomes weirdly difficult to follow. And then the substitute for the Enchanted Hunter's Hotel is called Lake Innuendo. You know, Nabokov's work is so incredible to read because it is so vibrant and so clever, and it's just filled with all of these little word games and puzzles and allusions, and it's a little bit depressing to read the words lake innuendo because it's like, you could have thought of an innuendo to put there, you know? I feel like Roger Fishbite never fully commits to being YA, and it never fully commits to being like a surrealist, postmodern Vonnegut kind of thing either. Like, if it's YA, it is surprisingly inaccessible. The content defies the form. The one thing I feel like Lo's diary did better than this one was it was genuinely unhinged and disjointed, which was painful, but at times very shocking. And on the note of empathy, the fact that Humbert and Charlotte in particular are pretty racist, and a lot of adaptations similarly have really honed in on that. And of course Lo, being the daughter of Charlotte and the stepdaughter of Humbert, is going to internalize some of these ideas, right? There are definitely some elements of bigotry that are worth exploring. That said, I don't think it's necessary to make Dolores Hayes super racist in all of these adaptations. And it's interesting because so much of the Nymphet fandom, so many people that I've talked to who are really big fans of Lolita, the fashion, and Nabokov in general are people of color.
A lot of people seem to think that the Nymphet community was filled with privileged white girls who like had daddy kinks or were sexually abused. That is not necessarily the case. Were some of the wealthier white girls? Yes, but not majority of them. There's only like three. No, actually there's only like two. Only two.
This to me is another case of description is not analysis. A racist Dolores Hayes is not necessarily an incorrect characterization, I suppose. But I guess if you're going to introduce these very caricaturish, honestly racist stereotypes into your book, you're gonna need to dissect deeper. In fact, I've spoken to a few fans of Lolita who've read Roger Fishbite and similar adaptations who are Black, Latina, and Asian, and none of them really appreciate this aspect. In the end, it doesn't really come across, as far as I've heard, as commentary so much as exclusion. I just saw this amazing video essay by FD Signifier, which I'll link in my description. He talks about how allies need to learn to knock on the door, because a lot of the time, white allies, and I'm sure I've made this mistake myself, they'll overstep their bounds, they'll open with these shockingly offensive racial stereotypes and be like, "Look how messed up this is, I'm helping." But what you're really doing is you're re-traumatizing or just not being respectful to your audience. Like, this idea that the fan base of Lolita isn't diverse is demonstrably untrue.
But the issue that comes, like the discrepancy that comes, is during the height of Nymphet Tumblr, when everybody knew what it was, everyone talked about it, there was like scholarly articles and there was blog posts about us. She claims it was only blonde girls. Who? She says it was only white girls there. What are you talking about? The amount of black girls there was staggering.
The thing is, Charlotte Hayes's racism and fetishization of other cultures definitely reads like a critique of American culture. There's definitely a satirical element to a lot of what she does in the original Lolita.
When asked in the above-mentioned Paris Review interview about his stance on domestic American politics, Nabokov answered resolutely, "I am anti-segregationist." Perhaps Nabokov, who sought throughout his life to be considered an individual, not part of any artistic group or literary movement, found something aesthetically repulsive about racial categorization. One could argue that part of why Humbert Humbert so successfully evades discovery as he takes Lolita from motel to motel is that white men, even white pedophiles, were not surveilled with the same force or regularity as black men engaged in the quote-unquote sex crime of miscegenation. The Mann Act, which made transporting girls and women across state lines for the purpose of debauchery illegal, looms in the background of Lolita. Humbert Humbert even refers to the Mann Act, though, in true Nabokovian fashion, his quarrel with the law is aesthetic in nature. I deplore the Mann Act as leading itself to a dreadful pun. The Mann Act was often employed to target black men who were carrying out consensual relationships with adult white women.
So yeah, here's the part where I talk about some of the racist caricatures in this book, so if you don't want to hear that, feel free to jump ahead to the next segment. But the line here is not really drawn, so... And a lot of the jokes made are made at the expense of the characters who are BIPOC. The Linderhoffs hire a Chinese maid named Chiang, who goes with Lucky to purchase new uniforms. She approves of them because they erase class differences. It's like a communism joke. Okay, we get it. I tried to enlighten Chiang, but she could not understand. They don't like us here, I told her. If you watch and listen, you'll hear. They don't enjoy us, children, and many of us are murdered every year. Like the Chinese girl? Chiang looked horrified. No, I had to reassure her. No, Chiang, it's really rare for a stranger to do it, by their own families and friends mostly, by people they know and love. You have a one-child policy too? Chiang was perplexed. No, Chiang, I said. We have a terrible fear of the future. And I'm just kind of like, she lives there. She moved to New York City. I feel like she would know that they don't have a one-child policy. Commentary, satire, massive air quotes around both those words. And there was Rosalita's boyfriend, Senior Lux. Rosalita lived in the complex too. She was big and blonde with deep red lips, and when I visited her, which I often did, to try on her high heels and learn to walk in them, Senior Lux would take my picture. First of all, Senor is misspelled. If you're gonna use the Spanish language in your book, maybe do it correctly. I am not even close to being a fluent Spanish speaker, and I know things like this. Hand on hip, he would cry in his funny accent, and then as he looked through the lens, he'd mutter, "Ay caramba," to himself. I was Linda in high heels, he said, something else for 4 and a half. I guess to me it doesn't feel like a nuanced portrayal of Texan Hispanic culture. I hitched a ride to the hotel with a Japanese businessman who tried to kiss me several times, but who was good-natured when I pushed him away. I did let him feel my breast in return for buying me some bullets, though. I'm not the authority on any of this, but 187 pages of it definitely got to be... So again, page 5, you see the issues starting to compound on top of each other. You have Prager imitating Nabokov's style. I was Linda in high heels is definitely, you know, she was Lola in slacks. Other than going on racist monologues, Lucky Linderhoff likes to go on homophobic monologues too. She was not always alone during this period. She did have her men friends, and many of them liked me. I know from Oprah that a lot of men are gay who don't tell you, but my mother's friend told me right away when I first met him. I'm gay, which is lucky for you. What a cutie, he exclaimed. She looks like a blonde Snow White. First of all,
what an odd thing to say.
Wouldn't a blonde Snow White be Cinderella? Or is this one of those like, wow, look at me, I'm so pale? I do like the fact that Charlotte Hayes was made into a Southern belle. I can't do a Texan accent, but I'm gonna try to do something Southern, okay? I'm waiting for a phone call.
Man, plantate this plantation. one second.
I'm waiting for a phone call, darling.
Linda, we can't pay him. Michael.
And I will also say that the characterization of Charlotte Hayes as a woman who is constantly surrounded by gay men, as a Michelle Visage, that's pretty funny and weirdly charming. I just don't like that so many of these gay men are so predatory and that they say weird things to the daughter. My mother's four best friends are gay men. They come around a lot. They've been here for a lot of my upbringing. We call them the gay aunties.
Huge disclaimer, the gay aunties came up with the name and like it and think it's funny. Obviously, we have them over for Thanksgiving, Christmas Eve. Don't panic.
That's just kind of how it is when you grow up in theater, but they certainly don't and never would behave the way that these men do. And a lot of the beauty related stuff, there's beauty queens and modeling and that kind of stuff in this book.
He moved in on July 25th, 1996. The day I learned that the life of a supermodel is not all glamour and fun. There was a conversation on MTV hosted by Cindy Crawford, and all the models were complaining.
I don't think I could model, I said. I'm too thin. Like, what the heck is that? Wow, I'm so pale. Wow, I'm so thin. No one could ever love me. So I guess what I'm saying is I feel like a lot of these adaptations should learn to knock. I'm not advocating for censorship or, you know, dumbing down the complexity of the interior psychology of Dolores Hayes. I guess I'm just saying, like, be considerate of who's reading.
Black girls are always told that they're not seen as pure or innocent from the ages of five. Like, kindergarten teachers even say they viewed black girls as more knowledgeable about sex, as more advanced, as less needing of protection. But the thing is, when you have a very narrow view of what is okay, it isolates a lot of people.
Those two things, the imitating Nabokov and to what end.
And there were other grown-ups, I know it. I just can't remember them now, but I will if I keep thinking. They come to mind like butterflies, these tiny wisps of memory.
And the overt racism really made it difficult to get to the end of this book. Dear readers and watchers of tabloid TV and press, I want you to know the truth. The water was gray, the deep gray of wet stones by a Chinese lake, a gray you couldn't see through. Yeah, I definitely feel like this referential style stunts the book. I never really feel like I got to know the voice of Emily Prager. It was just kind of Nabokov light. And that's part of the problem, right? Is like, he's one of the greatest writers of the 20th century.
We all have such fateful objects. It may be a reoccurrent landscape in one case, a number in another, carefully chosen by the gods to attract events of specific significance for us. Here shall John always stumble. There shall Jane's heart always break.
I feel like my brain is developing new wrinkles when I read his books. I can only dream of writing like him someday. And God knows I try. So would I allude to Nabokov this frequently? No, I wouldn't advise it. And it's also weird to me because these From Lo's perspective adaptations of Lolita give us the opportunity to see the world through her eyes. Part of what's so interesting about the original Lolita is the push and pull between Lo and Humbert. There's this back and forth because they're basically opposites, or at least that's how Humbert portrays them. She's young, he's old, she's outgoing, he's reserved. She's very interested in consumer culture, pop culture. He's very not. She's very American. He's very European. She's kind of brash and straightforward. Contrary to what a lot of the iconography and marketing that has proceeded would have you believe, she's kind of gross.
You kind of smell.
What the?
Like a maca.
So in writing a book from Lo's perspective, I feel like there's this opportunity you've been given to write someone completely new, or at least someone distinctly her own. I guess the question is, why write in Dolores Hayes' voice if you're not going to utilize it and you're just going to copy Nabokov's Humbert? And I find the way that precocious children are written to be very weird and off-putting a lot, including in Roger Fishbite. Was she warm? A psychiatrist at the facility asked me just after they brought me in, and I had to tell him I'm not old enough to answer that question.
I don't wanna pop! That's too much, man!
There's this kind of like omniscience that I think is supposed to signify wisdom, but it's like when TV writers will have a character be like, I don't like that guy who just rolled into town. I have a bad feeling about them, but it isn't based off of any evidence, and it isn't really based in their character. Like, obviously, if you have the town soothsayer say, ooh, I have witnessed a bad omen about this character, that's a completely different thing. So it's established pretty early on that the reason that Lucky Linderhoff is so educated and speaks with such a wide vocabulary is because she goes to private school. I think that's supposed to explain why she kind of writes like a fully grown adult, but for me, no, it doesn't really cut it.
Otherwise, it was standard male person stuff. A deco armchair, an old standing lamp, a double bed, a leather couch, a roll-top desk, a swivel desk chair, a small box of well-worn paperbacks. The trappings, now that I looked at them, of a private detective.
That's too much, man!
I don't know, to me it comes across as so overwritten that it hurts. And then there's the ever-intriguing question of, does the book Lolita exist in the universe of Roger Fishbite?
Just now, after some months here at the facility, I see that there exists a kind of grown-up man, his age between 28 and 90, who reveals himself to certain young girls painfully and utterly, those whom the old books call dirty old men.
That's too much, man.
And after a while, this whole alluding to Nabokov thing, if you want to start the book that way, I get it, but after a while, it honestly just kind of reads as lazy, it kind of reads as plagiarism.
The other day in the library here at the facility, I came across an old article in a magazine. Child actress gets a job was the headline. The story was about Miss Evie Naef, age 13, who, having been fired from a big musical a mere 2 weeks before it got to Broadway, has finally, it's been months, found employment as a spokesbabbler for a children's shampoo.
On page 18, she also says, the horses were docile. As I have already said, dear readers and watchers of the tabloid TV and press. And the frustrating thing is the best parts of the book are when Prager is writing as herself and not blatantly ripping off Nabokov.
Sometimes I think that grown-ups think that children are another species entirely, like little apes or something, as yet incapable of human sensitivity.
Here's another thing about borrowing from Nabokov's writing. Lolita was published in 1955. There is a lot of Lolita that is incredibly difficult to separate from its time period. One of the themes of Lolita is that it's often the person who is very charming and lovable and a member of your community that you least suspect. Conversely, Roger Fishbite, he's a non-character, but he's also a weirdo. The idea that all of these adults would find him super charming is difficult to accept. He says things like, yes, mistress, to Lucky, which comes across to me as very m'lady, you know? Versus with Lolita, where it's unreliably narrated, so did everyone love Humbert? You know, maybe. But he probably also, because he's so narcissistic, he probably thought that a lot of people loved him, and they probably didn't love him as much as he thought that they loved him, right? We can assume that within reasonable doubt. But in Roger Fishbite, it's being narrated by Dolores Hayes, Lucky Linderhoff, so we are left with no choice but to accept the idea that there is a guy running around going, mistress, I've been thoroughly lionized, and everyone likes him. It's bizarre, truly. But yeah, Lolita was published in 1955, and its main character is a pretentious literature professor, so reading statements like,
a veritable Proteus of the highway. With bewildering ease, he switched from one vehicle to another. This technique implied the existence of garages, specializing in stage automobile operations. But I never could discover the rummies he used.
That works, that is cohesive, but in Roger Fishbite, when Lucky Linderhoff says, were that true, then little girls would have no rest and certainly go mad. This book is set in 1996.
What's with you, kid? You think the death of Sammy Davis left an opening in the Rat Pack?
I don't think that 13-year-olds, even girls who go to private school, we're gonna be talking like that in 1996. It's just, it's the kind of thing where I'm like, I just don't, it doesn't feel very well thought out to me. I don't know.
And come to think of it, in contrast, Clueless does an excellent job of balancing the fact that its characters were wealthy and educated and, well, teenagers.
Excuse me, Miss Dion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, but street slang is an increasingly valid form of expression. Most of the feminine pronouns do have mocking, but not necessarily misogynistic undertone.
Wow. You guys talk like grown-ups.
Not to mention that this overly formal writing style is paired with all of these endless colloquialisms. Doesn't matter if it wasn't quite so wonderful for her, so having five O's. Just feels like this horrible battle between style and substance, like Emily Prager's voice is clawing to get some air. There are also a lot of pop culture references. I think what Prager was going for is like, well, Humbert Humbert alludes to literature so much. What if, when we focused on Dolores Hayes, she was talking about pop culture all the time? It's one of those things where I wish she had gone further with it and made her just a full pop culture geek, instead of just making her like a girl who watches TV, but don't worry, she also goes to private school, so she's not dumb. Like, she makes all these references to 1990s TV show hosts that I needed to look up, and that's the other problem, right? Is like, who is Sally Jesse Raphael? I know that I'm showing my age, but I do not know who that is. I had to look that up. Versus, who is Dante, Petrarch, and Poe? Well, they've been pretty popular for a couple hundred years. So yeah, when Humbert references them, I do know who he's talking about. On page 18, she talks about poor Irish kids, which again, it's like, what era is this? You know who the poor Irish kids were in the 1990s? You're looking at them. And here's the quote I wore the devil ears for. And whether I should go to heaven or hell is for you and God to decide. Under the circumstances, it's a difficult decision and each case is different. For example, the people from Disney think they're going to heaven, but after Hunchback of Notre Dame, God and I know they are going to hell. She writes Lucky Linderhoff to be a sympathetic character, but the commentary, if you can call it that, of television and pop culture of the 1990s, it doesn't really read like pop culture is just as valid as literature. There's something interesting to be said about young girls who are exclusively interested in pop culture. It just reads as very television bad, books good. Which, you know, to me is pretty invalidating, again, of the humanity of the original Dolores Hayes. And then there are all of these complicated explanations that are given to retaining the aesthetic of the original novel instead of just adapting it for the world of the 1990s. I actually kind of like the idea of having a Lolita-type story set in the 1990s. I mean, the 1990s had a whole aesthetic called kinder whore, so I guess I'll just say that it's not unprecedented to explore the sexuality of young girls within 1990s pop culture.
Kinder whore was a strong feminist statement. It was about so much more than a little velvet dress, ripped tights, and a dumb media-made label. It was about intentionally taking the most constraining parts of the feminine good girl aesthetic, inflating them to a cartoon level, and subverting them to kill any ingrained insecurities. It was about taking back the power and screaming, "You want the female sex? Here you go."
But then, like, on page 28, she says,
"Of course, I wear a uniform to school, so shoes are one of the few ways I have to show who I am. So I guess I'm a saddle shoe type of girl."
Why did Dolores Hayes wear saddle shoes? Because saddle shoes were super popular in the 1950s. This idea that if Dolores Hayes lived in the 1990s, she'd be wearing saddle shoes, I really don't think so. Page 41.
"He was amusing to have around, and it would be a lark to taunt him with other men later. Young, strapping lads with enormous Adam's apples and lots of promise would barely notice him as they came to squire me around the city. 'Good evening, Mr. Fishbite, sir. Nice evening, isn't it?' The thought of it delighted me."
1996. "Private school girls were stabbing people to death in that park, and they were going rowing. 'Let me see the daguerreotypes,' I would have demanded if I had had the chance, but Fishbite wouldn't have gotten the reference. And neither do I. Taking a minor across state lines for immoral purposes is an instant 20 years in a maximum security prison. I wasn't sure if this was correct, but neither was he. Nothing intimate. It's called sodomy, mister." 1996. About 50 pages in, and I'm just like, I do not care about Roger Fishbite as a character. I don't care about him at all. I didn't come to read an adaptation of Lolita from Lo's perspective to learn all about Roger Fishbite, because we're given, you know, his backstory, we're given so much detail about him, we're given so much detail about what he does, and I just feel like, meanwhile, the inner world of Lucky seems to be so desperately missing. Also, Fishbite is described as having like big, glossy, leering eyes and fishy lips, you know, like pouty and long. And I assumed that's where the name Fishbite came from because, you know, it's like he's just looking for some bait. It's a grotesque joke, but we'll take it. But the nickname was actually given to him by this woman who saw him laying on a pier and gasping for air, quite literally, like a fish out of water. I feel like all Prager ever does is describe how Fishbite feels, which is so disappointing. It's the opposite of what this book's mission should be. Why then first person? Why then her perspective? Like on page 83, Fishbite is described as absurdly attractive. And I guess I just have to ask, what's the real difference then between this text and the original Lolita if you're not going to question the ways in which Humbert was an unreliable narrator? Another thing I really do not like about this book is I feel like Emily Prager frames Humbert's nymphet theory as having credibility instead of him having an excuse to justify his own predation of little girls. In my humble opinion, Humbert's nymphet theory is mental gymnastics, right? It's part of the unreliable narration. It's a manipulation tactic that he uses to get the audience, the jury, on his side of things.
What makes one little girl honey to such wasps and another DDT, I must say, mystifies me. I only know that I am a little dollop of peculiar sweetness, and always have been. Is it something in my DNA? I wonder.
It doesn't matter what you look like as a little girl. It doesn't matter how you act. It doesn't matter how you dress. None of these are factors in how abusers choose their victims. This insinuation that Humbert Humbert was onto something when he waxed poetic about little girls, little nymph girls by the ocean who resemble Poe's Annabel Lee and Dante's Beatrice. Like, don't. And the fact that that's like a canonical part of the world building, no, really hate that. I could relay the ways in which, through her depictions of sexual behaviors, Prager, in my opinion, absolves the predator. She describes the sex acts, none of which are intercourse, and then he immediately feels very guilty about it. There's also the fact that on page 93, it says explicitly that it does not want to be pornographic. But unfortunately, Roger Fishbite spends a lot of time describing, in, I feel, kind of pornographic detail, sex acts between an adult and a minor. You know, at least Nabokov had the decency not to describe the specific sex acts happening between Humbert and Dolores. Like, the reputation of Lolita is that it's this incredibly pornographic book, but Nabokov specifically does not let the reader violate Dolores as they're reading Lolita. In that regard, Lolita is more respectful of victims than Roger Fishbite, which I guess is saying something. So about halfway through the book, Lo is sent to private school, and I was thinking, thank God, because that means that we can finally talk about her and her friends and her social life and her interests, and I can stop hearing about Roger Fishbite. The Chutney School is what it's called, and I felt like the Chutney School should comprise a lot of the book. It comprises 10 pages, and some of those 10 pages are dedicated to how Fishbite calls. So, I just think it's kind of amazing how this book barely passes the Bechdel test.
In the plastic box behind the gear shift, where people usually keep tapes, he had his well-thumbed paperbacks. "What's this about?" I asked, picking one up. He grabbed it out of my hand.
"A guy named Humbert. Men's stuff. Not for you. No princesses."
Now, the idea that Lolita exists within the universe of Roger Fishbite and Fishbite is emulating Humbert is kind of an interesting one. But I don't feel like they ever really go anywhere with it. And it's like, what if I wrote this book that points out how messed up Lolita is? The original Lolita already does that within the text. At the end of the book, Humbert goes through this horrible, like, agonizing guilt and eventually dies of heart failure because of it. So I guess it's just interesting because I always see people say that Lolita is, you know, an anti-feminist book, that it's a misogynist book, that it hates women. But then I see these adaptations of Lolita written from Lo's perspective, and I feel like they don't really touch on Lo's pain, Lo's grief, Lo's trauma. Unsay Lolita is the most challenging and inaccessible book, but I think there's a reason that a lot of smart, precocious young girls are drawn to it. It's not the easiest read. A lot is implied through allusion, through symbolism, and through implication. And you do have to go to the lengths to decipher what is fact and what is fiction. The thing that I thought was interesting is that Humbert and Quilty are combined into the same person. Lucky, as an aspiring theater person, murders Fishbite. It's interesting, but I haven't really made up my mind about how I feel about it. If Dolores and Humbert are contrasts, Quilty and Humbert are mirrors of each other. It's this tension between the ways that the two of them operate, the fact that Humbert finds Quilty immoral. Humbert kind of sees himself as like this knight-errant who's defending the honor of Dolores Hayes. And Quilty is like, dude, we are equally as bad. You and I, we are both terrible people, and we should just accept that. So the narrative ends kind of abruptly by introducing this group of girls from the Chutney school.
Our main problem, of course, in creating street theater about the sex industry in Thailand was what to do about the male aspect.
And it's just kind of like, make up your mind. Either you want to talk about the way that young girls are exploited in the home by people who are close to them in New York City, or you want to talk about the sex trade in Thailand. To anyone who's read Lolita, Roger Fishbite is a pale imitation. And to anyone it hasn't, I just don't think it holds up as its own story. Prager is attempting to draw a parallel between Humbert's literary obsessions and Lucky's TV obsessions, but unfortunately this falls apart for two reasons. One, because Lucky is incredibly literate, she goes to private school. And two, because literature is timeless. I guess the goal of this review is that I want people to stop recommending these Lolita retellings, specifically Lo's Diary and Roger Fishbite, instead of the original Lolita, because the original Lolita not only is a spectacular work of art, but it is also, weirdly, more feminist than these quote-unquote feminist retellings. Overall, I think Roger Fishbite is impaired by being an adaptation of Lolita. I think if similar to How I Learned to Drive, it was its own work that was heavily inspired by Lolita, it would be significantly better. But unfortunately, it is not. So...
this is a story about a girl named Lucky. Early morning, she wakes up, knock, knock, knock on the door. It's time for makeup, perfect smile. It's who they're all waiting for. There you go.
There are butterflies swooping by outside the window right now, which is like, it feels blessed.